Catoctin Creek is a proud supporter of Bourbon Pursuit. At Catoctin Creek, they pride themselves on making traditional rye whiskey as it would have been made in the 1800s. Virginia grain, Virginia water, Virginia barrels. Catoctin Creek, the Virginia rye whiskey. This is brought to you by Smooth Ambler, a proud member of the Bourbon Pursuit family. Smooth Ambler builds on the traditional roots of American whiskey through innovative blends, proudly sourced whiskeys, and a unique line of their own homemade bourbon and rye recipes made in West Virginia. So venture off the traditional trail and go see them in Maxwellton, West Virginia. They'd love to welcome you to the family that they're building around their whiskey. Wilderness Trail is sweet mash Kentucky straight bourbon and rye whiskey made by master distiller Shane Baker and fermentation expert Dr. Pat Heist. Whether it is high rye or wheated, cask strength or bottled and bond, Wilderness Trail is always non-chill filtered premium whiskey with unparalleled flavor. Distilled, aged, and bottled in Danville, Kentucky.
So what are we talking about today, Will it?
Yeah. Talk about purple tops.
Purple
right?
tops, yes. Purple tops.
Hey everyone, it's episode 313 of Bourbon Pursuit, the podcast featuring news, reviews, and interviews with people making the bourbon whiskey industry happen. I'm one of your hosts, Kenny Coleman, and before we start today's episode, talking about barrel picks from people who lead barrel pick programs, here's your weekly bourbon news update. Calling all bourbon and whiskey fanatics, this is your chance to earn $20,000 and be named World's Top Whiskey Taster. Back for a second year is Bardstown Bourbon Company's Whiskey Tasting Competition, where you can compete for a scholarship to Moonshine University, the opportunity to create your own blend with Steve Nally, get a sponsored block party back in your hometown, and a $20,000 cash prize. The first thing you need to do is sign up for the casting call, which will open on July 15th at worldstopwhiskeytaster.com. You just have to showcase your knowledge and enthusiastic personality. There will be five regional qualifiers based in Chicago, Dallas, New York, LA, and Atlanta, and those regional winners will be sent to Bardstown to compete for the grand prize. Once again, the casting call will open on July 15th at worldstopwhiskeytaster.com. The Kentucky Distillers Association has announced that Castle & Key, based in Woodford County, is the 43rd member of the nonprofit trade group. Castle & Key is also the KDA's 15th heritage level member, which is the highest rank for distilleries that age more than 50,000 barrels per year. And a new bill has declared that Indiana rye can be a legally binding and regional designation of whiskey. Distillers can now label their product with the term Indiana rye whiskey. And according to the new bill, in order for a whiskey to be called an Indiana rye, it must be either a sour or sweet mash with at least 51% rye as the base ingredient. It has to come off the still at no more than 160 proof, go into the barrel at no more than 125, and be bottled at more than 80 proof. The whiskey must be aged for a minimum of 2 years in new white American oak barrels. And with now more than 30 distilleries currently producing rye whiskey in the state of Indiana, it provides the lion's share of rye whiskey that is consumed on today's market, with its most famous being MGP, which creates for brands such as Bullet, Whistle Pig, Angel's Envy, High West, Redemption, and a whole lot more. Now moving on to bourbon release news. Remus Repeal Reserve Series 5 will be arriving in September from MGP. The final 100 proof blend breaks down as follows. Now stick with me because there's a lot of percentages here. 9% is a 2005 bourbon with a 21% rye mash bill. 5% of another 2005 bourbon, which is the 36% rye mash bill. 19% of a 2006 bourbon of the 21%. 13% of another 2008 bourbon, which is the 21%. And lastly, 54% of a 2008 bourbon of the 36% rye mash bill. This means that the barrels in the blend range from 13 to 16 years old, and they will have a retail price of $90. Now, we talk about barrel picks all the time on the show. Heck, we do 40 to 50 barrel selections per year with our private barrel program. But instead of hearing me talk about it, let's hear some stories from people that live and breathe it every single day. We're joined by Macaulay Minton of Wilderness Trail and John Wadell of Peerless Distilling. Both of these guys run the barrel select programs for each of their distilleries, and we get to know more about the programs and the do's and don'ts of going on a barrel pick. And speaking of barrel picks, we have a lot going on. We just released our 16 and 17 year old Whistle Pigs that sold out quickly, and we've got a lot more coming. We've also selected a barrel from Frey Ranch this week, so if you want to help support the show and get your hands on some great single barrel bourbons, come and support us. Patreon.com/bourbonpursuit. And Joe from Barrel Bourbon wants you to know that it's gotten a whole lot easier to get their unique cask strength whiskeys from around the world. Just visit barrelbourbon.com and click the Buy Now button. Bourbon to your door. It's as easy as that. With that, enjoy today's episode. And now here's Fred Minnick with Above the Char.
I'm Fred Minnick, and this is Above the Char. This week's idea comes from George Dunn, who writes me on fredminnick.com. Quote, okay, I'd be lying to you if I didn't say I wanted to be the Above the Char question. All right, George, here you go. You're here on Above the Char. What is your dental routine before competition tasting? Well, I've been asked a lot of things, George, and I don't think anyone's ever asked me about my dental routine. first of all, this is actually a great question. Early on in my career, I was around a lot of master sommeliers and a lot of people who were in like wine tasting competitions. And they would always tell me to not brush your teeth before a major tasting, to don't eat any onions or things like that. And I remember weighing my dental prowess over my palate. And I would go through times of not, you know, brushing my teeth. And I would taste. And I was like, I felt like my tastings were actually off when I didn't brush my teeth. And here's why. There's a film, you know, there's like a gunk, there's a grossness to your mouth when you don't brush your teeth daily or floss or use mouthwash. You know, so you have a layer of like crap on there. I can't give you like the scientific terminology here. I can just give you that like when I don't brush my teeth, I got me some dragon breath. So I'm trying to prevent dragon breath tasting scenario. So yeah, I do brush my teeth. I use mouthwash. I floss. I mean, I don't want to be tasting and have last night's steak hanging up in there in the on the top half, you know, decaying out and creating flavors on my palate. And I just don't want that. So what I have found over years of experimentation is that if I don't take care of my proper, no, if I don't take care of my teeth, but if I don't go through that process, then it will have a huge impact on my tasting for the negative. So I have no issues whatsoever with brushing my teeth, going through my daily stuff. What I've learned is when you try to change something, then you screw your palate up. And that's just my take. Every taster is different. And, you know, when I'm doing competitions, there will be people who won't brush their teeth. Am I talking to them in close proximity? Absolutely not. But that's going to do it for this week's Above the Char. Hey, if you want to know about any of my grooming techniques before tasting, be like George and hit me up on fredminnick.com. That's fredminnick.com. And maybe you will be read on the next episode of Bourbon Pursuit. But that's going to do it out there. Everybody, be safe out there. Cheers.
Welcome back to Bourbon Pursuit, the official podcast of Bourbon. Kenny and Ryan here today talking about one of the most favorite subjects that we get to talk about on this show, and that is private barrel selections. We've got our own private barrel selection program. We've done almost over 100 of them now, and it never gets old. That's the fun part.
It does not.
The
tours get old, but not the barrel selections.
There's nothing wrong with tasting more and more whiskey. And so we're going to be joined here by two guys today that are going to kind of give us an insight into more of the nuances that you see behind the scenes of a barrel selection program. We've talked about barrel selections. Ryan, you've talked about them being unicorns all the time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, everybody used to get geeked out over the limited editions, which is fine. But, you know, the true unicorns to me are single barrel selections. It's you're getting your own pick, your own barrel. And it's something, you know, the perfect thing about bourbon is like with a single barrel selection, it's never going to be replicated. You're never going to have the same wood. You're never going to have the same climate that, you know, that barrel experience for the 4 to 10, however long it's been. And so it's a truly unique barrel for you or your group or whoever it's for. And it's, they're always special. And like I said, they never get old. They're so much fun.
And we talk about the experience a lot, but we never talk about the actual
people behind it and what they have to go through.
Yeah, we just show up.
Yeah, we just like, show up and we're like, all right, where's the whiskey guys? But, you know, there's a lot of stuff that happens behind the scenes of actually going through taste testing and making sure these barrels fit the program.
Scheduling. Getting everybody coordinated, all these.
You know, I thought like I was.
Earned cats.
If I was good at Excel spreadsheets, these guys are probably masters at it. So, yeah. I mean, I'm sure there's all kinds of stuff they got to deal with crap like that. So, let's go ahead and introduce our guest for today. So today on the show, we have Macaulay Minton. He calls himself the barrel guru over at Wilderness Trail Distillery. And we have John Wadell. He is the single barrel program curator over at Peerless. So guys, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having us.
Yes, thank you.
So
yeah, thanks for bringing whiskey.
Yeah, absolutely. We got it.
It's always a plus.
We have single barrels with us here and some other kind of good Peerless distilling. We got an absinthe finish here. So let's.
It's getting crazy here.
I know. Let's go ahead and we'll rock.
Conversation might get weird. Absinthe leaking to our
I should have brought a king cake too.
Yes.
We could DoorDash that in.
Yeah, we need to look into that. So I want to kind of talk a little bit more about each one of your programs. You know, Macaulay, I'll kind of start with you first. You know, kind of give us an idea of, well, A, like how did you get into, you know, the whiskey and bourbon side of it? How'd you get into the single barrel side? And kind of talk a little bit more about the program in general too.
I guess I'll give you a little bit about my background. When I was in college, I decided I didn't want to go to law school. Wanted to pursue getting into master brewing is what I was into at that time. I actually went to Wilderness Trail on a field trip in college and got to meet Dr. Heist and see the lab at Firm Solutions. And I kind of put the math together. If I could get in there on know my fermentation, know how yeast works a little bit better and do that quality control, I could get a job landed anywhere. So I did an internship in the lab with them for about 6 months before they ended up hiring me to be a distillery operator at that point. I handled that job for around 6 months before I think I got tricked into this position being the bottling manager when we started bottling. Bottling and shipping receiving manager. So hand labeling, and hand bottling is not a fun task.
Oh, man,
so
sounds tedious.
Things have changed a lot since then, but after that, got into the visitor center operations, and then one day we started decided we were going to kick off our barrel pick program, and then started that out with doing a KDA barrel pick for the bourbon affair. So we had all the master distillers in there. I laid out a really good spread, and it was next level for them. They'd just been in rick houses all day, spitting on the ground, and when you come in, have a nice setup, nice crystal and charcuterie board and things like that. Get a little impression on that. So I got a phone call. Al Young called and was like asking me for some pointers on wanting to see how to do barrel picks. So I knew I'd made it at that point. So
we got Al Young giving you the phone call to figure out what to do.
Yeah. So that's when I knew I had the hat and the feather right there. So we've been kind of just morphing that program, growing that, getting it into different markets and just kind of trying to man the ship at this point. It's been spaceship ride to the top right now. I mean, we started out just in 2 states distribution a few years ago. Now we're in 33 different markets and get into the international market as well too. So sky's the limit on that. And I'm just interested to see where I am in a few more years at the position. Now we do a little bit more quality control. So tasting barrels, kind of getting on that side a little bit more. So the role has kind of been defining itself a little bit more as it goes, because there wasn't anyone before there. So I was able to go in and kind of set protocols, really develop a program that I wanted to do, because I did a lot of corporate espionage as well too. So
secret shopper.
So I did a little corporate espionage this morning, as I was telling you guys too. But it's good to go out and see what everyone else is doing on their barrel picks, kind of what they're offering, knowing what's out there. I've always had this misnomer of like, so with Kentucky and distilleries, that we always kind of have this perception of everything being a little bit more rugged. But I think that we're getting past that. We're starting to define spirits a little bit better, and we're having more educated consumers, and people are just dialing into things a little bit more. So being able to know what's out there and then being able to take that back and fine-tune your program a little bit more too. So it's nice being all doing that. So that's my little intro.
I liked it.
It's a pitch.
Yeah, that was a good pitch. So John, we'll kind of move it over to you now. So kind of same question, kind of talk about, you know, how you got into whiskey, how you got to Peerless and into this position, and, you know, more about the program.
Crazy. I always tell people just right place, right time. Like just so many variables that led up to even being there at Peerless. So I came from like a bartending background, and I met Caleb, our master distiller, through a mutual friend. And we started doing just like game nights, cocktail nights, and I come over and make drinks, we eat and stuff like that. And, you know, at the time I was working with like animals, like, you know, bartending, working with animals, enjoyed that stuff. And he approached me and was like, hey, I think you'd be really good here. And this was like in the beginning phase, like we didn't have any product out or anything. And he brought me on. He's like, if you don't like it, no hard feelings. And I never left after the first day. Like I kept coming back every day, every day. And I was about 3 months into it. They finally were like, come work for us full time. So I started working there, started off learning the mashing, like adding the grains, water, yeast, all that kind of stuff. From there, distilling, which is crazy, like just learning our still process and programming, considering that I'm sitting here with the master distiller that programmed, coded, and designed this whole system here. So it's like, you know, listening to somebody talk about their baby. So it was just great hands-on experience. And then product became of age, and we were new. There was only like 20 employees there. And it was one of those days where we started pulling barrels down and tasting them. And I remember walking through the lab, and it was Caleb, our master distiller, and Nick Clee, one of our other distillers. And I just asked, can I sit down and taste with you all? And they were like, yeah, pull up a seat. Like, we need all hands on deck. And I just tell people, I guess I had a good palate because Caleb said, hey, come back here tomorrow. We need you to come back and taste. And then we had a barrel program coming about. People were asking about single barrels. And I guess I showed the most excitement about it. Like, I was like, can I help select these? Like, I want to do this. And at first Caleb started off with it, and I'd set up everything for him, have everything laid out by the time the groups come in. And I think about 2 weeks into the program, he approached me again and said, hey, I think we want to let you run this program. And ever since then, I've just been you know, leading up the program. And as he was kind of saying, Macaulay, it's so nice. Like, it's so hands-on at a craft distillery. So, you know, our program, you know, we taste every single barrel that goes into it. Because when barrels become of age, we're not just looking for single barrels, we're looking for small batch ones to hold back. So it's really so hands-on from beginning to end. I mean, we're hand selecting, curating these barrels that we put in. So we're making sure that we put, I believe as you said, the Easter egg, like just the best of the best barrels we can possibly put in there. And from there, then on, we still curate, like when it becomes selection days, you know, myself, Nick Clee, our other distiller, we sit down, we taste them, we'll hand select the barrels we put in the program, because not only do we want them to be different, we want them to be just different from each other. We want to show off a little bit of that range that we have within our rick houses. And yeah, it's been great. I've been able to kind of shape the program and kind of lead off from there and set the standards. And speaking of Al Young came down to Peerless one day. And like you said, that's when like you knew, like when you're like, all right, we must be doing something right when Al Young's down there hanging out asking about your program.
That's really cool.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
So talk about,
well, hold on. Before you get there, there's a question I want to pose you. What were you doing with animals?
I was working like as a vet.
It's an important question. I
was working
know what
with exotic animals as like a vet tech, you know.
Really?
And we also had like a dog boarding place with like doggy daycare and stuff like that there. I just really enjoyed like working with animals was just so rewarding. Like, it really was.
They don't give me any shit.
But I'll be honest. It's hard to make a living off of that. You know, you don't get paid much in that field. So that's why, you know, I was doing bartending. So I'm born and raised here in Louisville, Kentucky. And I've always had a passion for, I mean, I remember sneaking into my mom's liquor cabinet and drinking whiskey and bourbon at such a young age.
It's okay. You're not
it's
not incriminating. It's not incriminating at all.
That's where the palate got defined.
Yeah.
Liquor cabinet.
You know, grew up drinking just some cheap stuff. And then here I am now, like working at a distillery. And 6 years ago, I would never believe I'm doing what I'm doing now.
Yeah, it's awesome.
That's a great story.
Yeah. All right. One more question. Like, what's the most exotic animal you did handle?
Kenny's way into the
well, it's interesting.
God, where do I start? I mean, I guess I would say the coolest one is an owl. If you've never seen an owl, like spread
owls
out,
cool,
like
yeah.
under like sedation, like an owl will mess you up.
Yeah,
like
predatory.
Oh my gosh, yeah, the talons and the claws on that thing.
And they can spin their head around.
Yeah. That was probably the most fearful animal I saw, like probably come through there. But pigs, I mean, you name it, man, we had it in there. Besides like larger animals, we didn't deal with like horses or anything like that. But it was a crazy, crazy, crazy experience there working at that place.
All right, back to business, Brian.
All right, back to birth. So you talked about how you all taste everything, and you know, you kind of like say, all right, you're going to the single barrel program or small batch or vice versa. Is there like a formula that are in your head, like, okay, we need X amount we want to do for just single barrels, X amount for our small batch, X amount for, you know, so is there like a like a certain percentage that you're able to like allocate towards just single barrels?
So yeah, I mean, I do get only a certain number a year that we are allowed single barrels, just because you've got to make sure we're holding enough back for, you know, X amount of years. So we have older age statements. So I say it's the toughest thing, because at that point, when you depend on what you're allocating for the year, you have to say no to people, which I hate doing. Like, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry, we're full this year. Like, that's probably the hardest thing about the program for me, because you always want to have that connection and stuff with people.
Because the brand, you probably want emphasis on the everyday, you know, brand or whatever, but your whiskey geeks enthusiasts want the single barrels. So it's got to be a hard balance.
Yeah, yeah. Because you got to take care of your stores that help push, you know, your small batch and things like that. But then you also want to get your product in the new hands too.
Yeah. And you know, you both are different scale levels as well, as about how many barrels are coming out per day. Both of you are kind of around, you know, 4 to 6 years is some of the oldest whiskey that you are producing or putting out today. So you are kind of like in parity in regards of age and stuff like that. But yeah, in regards to scale, it's a little bit different. I know Peerless is a few less barrels per day than Wilderness Trail.
Oh man, like,
yeah. Just a few.
Their production is awesome at Wilderness Trail.
Yeah, so I mean, when you are trying to hold stuff back, yeah, it must get a little bit tougher knowing you've got to hold stuff back to get more maturity, but you do want to release something.
Yeah, it's a little rough, just because you do, like I said, you always want to push, and I'll always ask for more, you know, like, hey, can I get a couple more barrels? I mean, got to try at least, but you know, we're very good, and it's like I said, eventually we'll do more eventually in the future. We're just trying to make sure we have enough for older stuff.
All right, Macaulay, on to you then.
So we just discussing how we have different production means going on. So when we started out our program, we were still on our pot still at the beginning. So this year we've got onto our larger production using that 16-inch column. So we're just being able to tap into more barrels at this point. So right now we're running around 350 barrels for our barrel pick program, but
per year
now.
Gotcha.
That might, in 2022, that's going to increase because we're going to be on our larger column, so we're going to have more juice that we can tap in, but we're still going to keep it around that 4 to 5 year old mark, because last year we didn't offer any weeded bourbon, for example, because we had our 6 year old release. So when I'm hitting those barrels for the barrel pick program, that's a barrel that takes away from 8 year old. That's one less barrel for 6 year old program. So it's kind of,
you're like, come on, Shane. Come on, Pat. Yeah. Give it up.
Well, exactly. So, and then it's always having to deal with those requests. Like, I've got a charity group, I've got a friend that wants something a little special. Like, so trying to take all those things into consideration and keep the big game pitcher as the North Star objective is difficult to do, because I am also a yes man. I would like to just make everyone happy, give sure. them whatever. Let's drink whiskey, have a good time, do some business. But there are larger constructs of that too. We do have to figure out case allocation. It is the way we do our allocation. It's going to be based off sales across our core SKUs. So our small batch, high rye bourbon, our single barrel bottle and bond weeded bourbon, and then that cask strength rye whiskey. And that's kind of how we spread it around. And it is what it is. I just can't pull more aged whiskey out of a barrel. And that's one thing that people on the other side of the phone don't realize, is when they're calling me, we're getting backed up on sample requests. Well, I only have a window of barrels that are now 4 years old. Just because you saw the news the other day or read an article, it says we have 100,000 barrels. It doesn't mean
they're not
that
already.
There's 100,000 barrels that you want to pick right now. Most of those are super green still, if you will. So being able to just get into that. Right now, we're starting to trickle out of our different warehouses as well, too. Last year, most of our product was in the smaller warehouse, our 2,000-barrel rick house. Now, we're starting to pull some items out of B, which is going to be that 16,000-barrel rick house. And then next few years, we'll get into those larger rick houses as well, too. So being able to play around with rick position, location, and things like that is something I look forward to as we start developing more of these aged spirits.
Very cool.
There's another question that you brought up, and I want to pose it to you all, because I'm sure that you get requests all the time, whether they're private barrel groups like us, and we're like, hey, can we get in? Like, I want to get a barrel.
End of the year, we need one.
Or, you know, and they're like, oh, you know, we're doing a fundraiser for this children's hospital. Like, how do you deal with that? Like, how do you deal and try to figure out, like, it's hard to play favoritism, and then you've also got your allocations to stores that are based on sales. like talk about like the internal turmoil that you have to face to try to figure out like who gets a barrel.
Cost benefit analysis.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. Usually I, and when it comes down to that, I may pass it on to someone else, but like someone higher up, like I need you to make this decision. But no, you know, it just, that's a darn good question. I think a lot takes into factor. I mean, a lot of times on those situations when it's an extra group like that, fundraisers, we just pull an extra barrel for the lot for the year. Like we'll find an extra barrel just to give them.
Now you're gonna get all these calls.
Yeah, I know.
Right? Like, always I got a fundraiser going on.
Yeah. I got a new charity going too.
Yeah. I need help. Started a 501c.
I just started it. Yeah, exactly.
But I think you know with that, you know, it just depends a lot on reps, which I don't think a lot of people realize. Like you work hand in hand with your reps in every state and things like that, and you just got to make sure it's a good fit. And I hate saying no. I really do. It's one of the hardest things, and we really do like do everything we possibly can to try to see if we can't fit it in, but sometimes you just gotta give them the big NO.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But you put them on a waiting list. Like we still stay in contact. With that being said, always make sure
today doesn't mean no forever.
Yeah. I try to reach out to them at least once a month just to check in with them, make sure like, hey, kind of keep them up to date on where we are with the program and everything too. Cause we do get cancellations too throughout the year.
Sure.
A big part of that is managing relations with our distributor partners. Honestly, those are the guys that have the cards in their hands and are able to make the calls. They know their market better. They know these individual customers better, and they have better judgment where it calls, where this barrel needs to go at the end of the day. At the end of the day, we're a business. We need to be able to grow that brand. We're trying to push those core products, and we are wanting to help out people as much as possible too. But discretion's not all in my hands though. So I get requests all the time. People want to schedule barrel picks, but I always have to pivot that over to the distributor partner at this point.
Is that who you, I guess, look to mostly as the distributors to like say, this is your deal to decide who's going to get the barrels and don't let them come at us, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. The worst part though, I think one of the comments that stings the most is when they're like, so you're not the guy I need to talk to. Then I'm just like,
oh wow.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
But I'm the guy's guy though.
Yeah.
I'm the gatekeeper to the guy.
I choose the barrels that go into that selection. Yeah.
That's awesome. So I want to talk about, you know, you talk about you guys went out and like did the secret shop or whatnot before, you know, going to different barrel picks. What are some things that, you know, you liked about other people's programs and maybe some things you didn't like that, you know, you were like, we don't want to do it that way at our place.
Well, didn't like in the nicest possible way you can say.
Well, yes.
I can kick off with didn't like in the nicest possible sense from one I did this week. I get it that not everyone knows what's actually going on when you're doing a barrel pick and there's people that are just trying to help you get things done and things like that. But we're at X Distillery and we're doing our barrel pick and the lady looks at me and she's like, she's questioning me, swirling my glass and nosing it. She told me that I was smelling my bourbon wrong and I was tasting it wrong. And it was kind of like mic drop situation because everyone in the room was just like looking at each other like, oh my God. It's like she gave me the bait, switch and hook. She was like, why are you doing it that way? Had me explain it, blah, blah, blah. You know, gave her the scientific aspects of it. And then she's like, oh, you're wrong. My master distiller told me it was this. The paper says this. Like, but I was just blown away. Like, and then after I was leaving, I slid her my business card and kind of let her know what I did a little bit. So she came up to me in the gift shop and she's like, I'm sorry if I offended you. And I was like, well, you didn't offend me, but I'm going to tell you something. I was like, there's so many different methods out there. I was like, what I do works for me. It doesn't work for, it might not work for you. What you learn and what you apply works for you. Go with what works for you. But don't tell me what I'm doing wrong. I was like, I come from a wine background, beer, and I've taught hundreds of people to this classes. I was just a little perplexed. I was like, huh, I've taught hundreds of people how to do bourbon sewer programming. And I don't know. Like, so that was just interesting. At the end of the day, it don't matter how you drink it. You can put Mountain Dew or Dr. Thunder in there, whatever you got cooking around.
Your barrel.
Like as long as you are buying it, that's what counts, in my opinion. But step one, you like it or don't. It don't matter how you smell it, lace it around, swish it around, like, and don't tell me how to drink it at that point.
Like, but on the flip side of it, have you found a distillery that you're like, oh, I really like what they're doing over there?
Honestly, Mandy down at Four Roses, I think she's got it going on. That was one of the great experiences I've been on. I think she has a great program down there, good offerings. I'm a fan of being able to taste what I'm getting in my bottle. So if I'm going to be selecting something that's 94 proof or something like that, let's taste it at 94 proof. I don't need to play a guessing game of falling in love with this high proof bourbon to get it watered down and not like it when I get it back to the store or to the bar or anything like that. Sure. So let's just cut out the middleman on that. That's one thing I oppose on that. Like let's taste what we're getting in our bottle. Let's cut out this proofing scheme. Let's just get down to it.
Just go straight cash drink. Yeah.
Well, exactly. That's, you know, cash drink, ball and bonds, the only way to go.
Right.
What about you, John? Have you seen anything that's been kind of like, you're like, I don't really see what they're doing, but I really like this?
Two things I just never get is, you know, one, why they taste like in a cold brick house. Like when you're out there, like I've been on several beers. Yeah. Like, I'm like, what? You're not going to drink your whiskey at that that's temperature. You're not going to, I don't know. I just never got the whole setting of that.
Make sure you explain people why. I mean, I know we know why, but make sure you explain people why, because it does change the whiskey entirely.
Yeah. So, I mean, drinking it compared to when it's, you know, maybe 34, 20 degrees in a rake house tasting your bourbon or whiskey out of a barrel compared to when it's room temperature or when you're in the rake house and it's like 100 and something degrees in there. That affects the flavor of the whiskey tremendously. So, like I said, between like Wilderness Trail, they do a great job, kind of same way we do it too. You know, we're inside, we're in a
comfortable. That's not what you said before the show.
Yeah, I know. But he's here now. No, you know, you sit down, you're comfortable. Like you're in your everyday setting. Like how would you be enjoying it sitting around with friends like we're doing now or just in a bar? So I never understood that aspect of just tasting it out right out in the rick house. And then same thing, like why am I tasting it at barrel proof if this isn't how I'm going to receive it? That's almost like, I don't know, like tasting food, like here, taste this raw steak. Yeah, yeah. Like, so yeah, if you're serving to me at 94 proof, before I get here, like obviously I'm spending the time, the money to buy a barrel from you, proof it down to what it's going to taste like for me. With the sample, you can get pretty close to it that way. So I guess I never understood those two things, why they do it that way. But, you know, and it's not just because he's sitting here, but, you know, once again, I love just being able to sit down, relax, not feel like I'm rushed or, you know, have to put on 20 layers of clothing or hope that I don't have a heat stroke while picking barrels.
Yeah, it is great to be in the warehouse just because you are like around the barrels, but at the same time,
sensory overload.
But it's sensory overload. Like you got smells and sights and sounds.
Absolutely.
Feeling, but with the cold, the heat, it does throw you off. And that's what I like about both of your alls, because you both take us in a, you know, an intimate setting room where we can hang around, you know, bullshit, kind of be just inside and kind of have a great experience without having all that outside influence on us.
You know, let it open up. You know, that's one thing I love, you know, when we're sitting there drinking and you're having a good time tasting, going through your barrels, you know, next thing you know, 20 minutes has gone by and you went back and revisit your glass and it's changed and then you got a whole different opinion about it. And that's how I truly think you will pick and find the best barrels out there.
Because you can go down to the warehouse and pull out the grossest barrel ever on an ice cold day and it's going to taste good.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, it's like putting your bottle in the freezer, you know, a Goldschlager in the freezer.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
And we've done that. I mean, we've experimented, you know, board down there. We'll pull, you know, maybe 10 samples, try them out, then, you know, set them back, let them get room temperature, go back. And just for fun reasons, you know, educational reasons, I guess.
Your own education.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But there's intention of doing that, though, which I think both of us realize that. And that's why we set up our programs to shine out our spirits and not try to mask it behind another layer of water or any kind of humidity or coldness that's out in the warehouse. So we're going for what we're actually trying to purchase and select for that day.
Yeah, I always like telling people,
you taste it when you get it.
Whatever you're tasting now, that's going to be what we bottle and send to you.
And then one thing I kind of feel interesting too is both of us come from a whole background of working in the distillery, though. We weren't just somebody that got pulled out of the gift shop on a slow day and got picked in there. Like,
can you fog a mirror? You're running the barrel program.
They just didn't like give us samples like, hey, this is what they're going to be tasting today. So yeah, definitely. I think there's a you're there from start to finish, you know, whether you taste at the barrels, you put these barrels in the program. And I'm not going to lie, you get a little attached to some of these barrels. Like when you taste them, like, this is a great barrel. Like, and it
I don't want to see this one go.
Yeah. Yeah. Like you're like, how can I?
I got to snick a bottle off of there.
Yeah. Like, who can I give this to locally?
that's always the joke. Why are we always getting rid of the good barrels right now? Like holding back nothing for us.
There you have that. So there's another thing about remote picks, right? When you have to deal with, you know, you send 3 barrel samples off to, you know, Idaho, California, Texas, wherever, and you've got to sit there and you've got to hold that inventory until they select it. And they're like, oh, we need another week. We need another week. How hard is it to sit there and say, like, I've got to look at my inventory and I could be like, guys, like, you've got like maybe a day left before I release these barrels and send it to somebody else. Like, how does that situation work?
My barrel program, we don't do samples generally, but with COVID, we have all had to make exceptions to the rules and we have opened up to doing sample program because the way I view the barrel pick program is I see it as an extension and arm of marketing and sales department. What other industry are you forcing somebody to come spend $15,000 and you make them fly across country on their own dime to pick it out? We're not flying out. We're not going to Southern California and buying a used car without any bait to go out there, for example. Yeah. So it's just more education and getting people involved. So that's what the whole barrel pick program is supposed to be evolved around, not just hitting numbers, making it a little bit more sales, because it really doesn't make a difference between turning a barrel into a barrel pick program select versus a SKU brand on the financial side. Essentially. So it just is an educational tool for us. So when I started doing sample packs, we started incorporating doing a lot of Zoom sessions, which is nice because there's some people that we just wouldn't have engaged with before. We've opened up our audience a little bit more doing that as well too. We've done programs with the British Bourbon Society, which is a humongous group, thousands of members. We have Zoom call with them with 200 guys on it. So it's been interesting to be able to connect in a different way that I was kind of just whole blocked out on before, but it is a huge pain in the ass though.
I can imagine not only shipping out samples and keeping track of them, but making spending sure your nights
break.
And then you got to spend your nights on a Zoom call, you know?
Well, you spend the nights on a Zoom call. And then when they select a bottle or select a barrel, you're like, oh, okay, I got to go back. And like, all right, well, I got to go re-pour all these ones and then ship them out to somebody else. Like it's a lot of labor that goes into it too.
But what's worse, doing that or scheduling on-site visits?
Spirits of French Lick exploded onto the distilling scene early in 2016 as Indiana's largest double pot still distillery. They employ old world sentiment with new world attitudes, delivering the finest handcrafted bottle and bond bourbons to an audience eager for an alternative to the big guys. And their distiller, Alan Bishop, uses historic Hoosier yeast strains, alternative grains, and 53-gallon number 2 char barrels to bring you spirits with unparalleled quality and depth of flavor. You can find all Spirits of French Lick's products and new releases on sealbox.com. But don't just take Fred Minnick's word for it. Find out for yourself. Check out spiritsoffrenchlick.com and follow them on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. And remember, always drink responsibly. Total Wine & More is ready for summer. They've got all your pours for the great outdoors, like their top 12 wines under $15. And raise a glass to America with a star-spangled selections of sips made in the USA. And beat the heat with refreshing bourbon cocktails. Why not mix it up and serve a brown derby or a peachy keen at your next barbecue? Then taste your way to a new flavorite, like ready-to-freeze cocktail pops and fun fizzy hard seltzers. Lime, pineapple, and peach, anyone? So no matter if you're grilling, chilling, or both, you're sure to find cool prices on over 8,000 wines, 4,000 spirits, and 2,500 beers in-store or totalwine.com. Heaven Hill Distillery just launched a 3D behind-the-scenes tour of their Bernheim Distillery, the largest independent family-owned bourbon distillery in the world. See for yourself how they produce 1,553-gallon barrels of new-make whiskey per day before it makes its way to the barrel for aging. From grain trucks to copper stills, drop into this 3D experience at heavenhilldistillery.com and navigate your way around the distillery for a step-by-step look at how they crafted their award-winning lineup of American whiskeys. Heaven Hill reminds you, think wisely, drink wisely. Cheers.
What's worse, doing that or scheduling on-site visits?
I'd rather do the on-site visits as well, just because it's a different ballgame when you can get them down there and show them what you do, especially like with these new groups and things like that compared to shipping out samples.
But I'm saying like just hurting, you know, like getting everybody on the same day, like same schedule, you know.
I'd rather do on-site for sure.
It's easier to schedule those versus the dealing with the samples on Zoom.
I hate emails. Like I know you're trying to like, I know it's 2021, but like I hate emails. Like call me. Like just call me, end it right there instead of like back. Ah man, emails are like my worst thing probably.
Same page there, brother. I'm like, for some reason I'll take a text message, but you an email, I'm like
yeah, I'm a text or call guy myself.
I get a phone call from reps probably once a day or several times. You check your email yet? I'm like, no, I haven't. They're like, God, I sent you an email like 2 hours ago. I'm like, all right, I'm looking.
Well, you gotta set out like a window of like 2 hours to go and get caught up with the emails. That's just usually how it works.
Yeah. And you know, shipping out samples on that, you know, side of things. So starting off, you know, we did ship out just because, you know, people are like, I can't make it to you. I really, or, you know, your reps are out there excited. Like these accounts have been pushing your stuff. Like they want to do a barrel, but now we've learned our lesson. I won't ship out any samples unless I have a selection date now. So like, all right, you want to pick a barrel? That's great. Give me an exact date and I'll make sure the samples are there by that time. Cause it does free you up, you know, being a craft distiller. I think they forget, you know, we make 10 to 12 barrels a day at Peerless. So it's not like I have 1,000 single barrels in my arsenal, no problem. You know, we're talking maybe at a time, I may have 15 barrels at that time that I can, we consider single barrel quality. Well, if I got 3 out on the market for a month, you know, it does me no good. That just takes 2 out of the inventory. So yeah, we're very, very strict on that part now with the single barrel, just because, you know, we want to make sure we connect with everybody we can and give everyone the same experience.
So we've come to the conclusion now that coming in person is by far the most authentic way to be able to do it. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. I mean,
you get a lot more
doing it over Zoom is okay. Right. It gets the job done.
It's nice doing them in your sweatpants.
At the same time, if you come in and we decide that the barrels that I selected for us to taste that day aren't in the direction that you're wanting, we can pull some other samples. If you come in and say, this is what I'm looking for, X, Y, and Z characteristics and this rye whiskey, then I'm going to go ahead and pull those barrels or pull samples from that and not waste our time on something. If you want full robust spice, or do you want floral and delicate? Like, let's talk about it. Let's get this figured out instead of kind of
you bring up
wasting
point.
Time.
Is there like, someone that's ever been like so difficult and they're like, oh, I'm just not feeling it. And you're like, oh, I got, you know, I can't please you, you know?
Well, at a certain point you got to draw the line because you're personally liable. I mean, I can't just have an all you can drink affair there. Sure. And just let someone walk out the door. So you just have to draw the line at some point. And generally, I mean, I personally curate all the barrels for the program and have a team that works with me on approving those too. So I know there's something good on the table. It's right. Not like I've just been circulating C6 for 10 months on the table waiting for some sucker to pick it up. That, or
that lady at that other distillery might have other things to say.
Exactly.
No, yeah, that's a great point. You know, there's 3 of us. So, you know, I get to curate every barrel that goes in the program. But the good thing is with the make it in the program, there's myself, Caleb, and Nick. All of one of us, Caleb's nice enough to give everyone a veto power. So as he was saying, like, we know these are some of the best barrels we have that are in the program. Just because if, you know, I like it, Nick likes it, Caleb doesn't like it, it doesn't go in, or vice versa. So that's one thing about Caleb, which I think is very respectful, that he really does value everyone's opinion. And everyone's on that panel for a reason, because we do have, you know, good palates, and very different is also what I love, because I'm not a big earth guy on the palate. So, you know, I look at those, I'm like, ah, but is it a bad barrel or is it just not my flavor?
Just not yours, yeah.
Yeah. And whereas Caleb comes in, he's like, he loves those. I mean, that's like one of his favorite profiles in a barrel.
Well, speaking of things that are kind of off profile, I brought some bottles with us, and I think everyone has a pour of the Wilderness Trail pick that I brought.
The bourbon.
So I actually brought, I teach a bourbon steward class at the distillery, and we do a barrel pick simulation at the end, if you will. So we'll do a barrel pick at the end, and we'll offer three different cask strengths that you can select for it. So the barrel that we have all poured right now is something that I actually kicked out of a lineup one day, and I was heading home to lunch, and I was thinking about it, and I was like, did I really not like that barrel, or was it just different? Was it just the most like off the wall barrel in the whole lineup? And I was like, yeah, it was. I was like, I need to go back and give it another touch. And I ended up bottling it instead of just blending it out in a small batch or something like that. But I'll let you guys try it out. So that's something when I'm curating barrels too. Like there's a difference in going through there for quality control and saying this has flaws, this has flaws. Like I need to nix it. And there's a difference in going through and tasting and saying, hey, this is a barrel that I need for my program. This has these nuances.
It's
exceptional, different profiles than maybe what our standard core kind of family is, if you will.
So when you think about when, you know, Ryan and I would come in, like I know that you all have gone through extensive research, if you will, of tasting and whatever it is that goes. I mean, it's probably the best part of the job to make sure that you're tasting the best whiskey that possibly can come from your distillery for this. If you give us three samples and I'm like, I don't know if something's here for us, is that okay, or is it like slightly annoying?
You know, it's, you would think it may be annoying, but honestly, one thing, me personally, I guess, with our program, I love the brutal honesty. Like, don't sugarcoat it. Like, tell me like why, because then that helps me figure out like, all right, was it a bad barrel, or it's like just not his flavor? Like, what are you looking for? So that's why also too, before they come in, I always like talk to the groups, like, what are notes that you like? Like, what don't you care for, or your consumers don't care for? I don't find it annoying, but maybe that's just me, just because I do like a good challenge too.
I'm usually reserved. Like, I'm like, I know like people like you all put a lot of work into this. And so like when you bring out barrel samples, I'm like, okay, this is what it is. And I don't
know what they're doing.
I hate to be a picky person and be like, guys, like, I don't know about
this. Fortunately, we haven't had to do that at both your all's, either one of your all's places, but.
I'll have to just say one thing. Don't compare our products to an 8 and 12 year old whiskey that is your favorite. That's not our offering. We're selling 4 year old whiskey. That it is what it is. Don't come in and say it's young, it needs a few more years, things like that. If that's your opinion, that is your opinion.
I would
also love a 16-year-old weeded bourbon from Wilderness Trail. Trust me, I think anyone at the table, I would want it more. So it is what it is. Like, don't say it's young, things like that. I'm not offended by that, but we're not out here searching for an old whiskey. If you're in the market for that, then don't come to me. We don't need to buy something for the sake of buying it. Don't buy something because you're there. Buy something because you love that barrel. That's something that you want to bring back to your store, your group, and tell a story of your experience with us, what you think about us, and how you guys came together on that.
And I think that's the fun part too about doing barrel picks with you guys is like, yes, it's young whiskey, but it's so unique and so different from your typical standard Kentucky profiles. You know, yes, those are great, but they all have, you know, similarities. And with, you know, your all's two offerings, it's like something that you can be like, look, yes, this is 4 year olds, but look at how much, you know, vibrant flavors there are that are not in your typical Kentucky bourbon profile yet, you know. So it's what I like about, you know, the good younger whiskeys out in the market.
You know, on his point, I mean, that's a good point. So yeah, I guess it is a little bit annoying, I guess, when they're like, oh, a little bit older, and you're like, you know our age, you know what our product product is. Like, it's not like we have 12-year-old whiskey sitting in the back. But if like you're like, hey, like the flavor profiles, I don't like things like that. I love to work around that, because I'm like, all right, well, I'm gonna make sure you're happy. But yeah, I would agree with that. Yeah, absolutely.
What if I'm just getting, I guess you could say, greedy, and I'm just like, I just want more samples to choose from.
That's, I can smell that.
Yeah, that's, we can read that.
You can smell that bullshit.
I can smell that.
Yeah.
We're not here to just get drunk. We're here to do business. This is a fun experience, and maybe a lot of people don't do this on a day-to-day operation, but generally, let's just say we have 6 group size in there. One person's on the financial line for it. The other guys are just there on their day off for a good day.
You're right.
I get a paycheck for buying and selling barrels. I do this for a living. This is serious. So you got to kind of take all that in consideration at the same time.
I mean, because, yeah, I mean, it's a little bit of, like, I guess your reputation on the line. Like, you know, I mean, they are picking the barrels, but at the same time, like, you're saying, like, hey, this is what I thought the best product was out there, too, as well.
Well, a different thing that I see both of our programs compared to a few others is, for better lack of words, in charge of curating and selecting these barrels versus somebody who is just getting X, Y, and Z box from bottling, or someone up the corporate ladder that says, hey, this is the offer in this month. Not everyone has the privilege of going down with the DeWalt and
so cool to be a part of. Yeah.
The DeWalt. Like, I like that. There,
there is nothing better, like, seriously, than seeing that fresh barrel head and pulling that first sample of barrels becoming of age and taking them back and tasting them. Like, yeah, I mean, it's truly fascinating to be part of that, and not just being like, as you said, hey, here's the barrels that we chose for the program so far. So yeah.
Yeah. Cause
yeah, that you make a good point. Cause a lot of, you know, master distillers or other people that they're not involved with the single barrel program are deciding that these are, here's your allotment and whatnot.
You mean the medallion on the side that says the master distiller pick isn't the actually master distiller pick, Ryan?
It's probably more of the quality control panel going through that, but
it happens. It happens.
I'm sure he sips it at least once.
Or the one that got mislabeled or didn't sell.
Yes.
There you go. There you go. So what is some of those things that you shouldn't do? Or like, can you talk about some stories without naming names that are like bloopers of like things that have happened? You're just like, guys, just don't do this, please.
Well, we don't need to stay up all night the night before and be drinking all morning.
I've made that mistake. I'm sorry. Not a year old, but another.
It happens to everyone.
I blame Kenny.
But
he took me to Lolo before a barrel pick one night.
But I mean, let's not blow out our palates on Indian food the night before, or you know, something funky on the way up. Like that's one thing I try to keep cognizant of when I'm doing tastings or selecting barrels. Like that might not be a big thing, but I mean,
don't go eat like garlic Alfredo.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, because it's gonna affect your taste buds the next day, as we all know. But I mean, Don't get drunk and show up, and probably the number one thing, because I don't know, like I was saying, this is an experience that people just think it's all drinking, all fun, but I take this serious. I mean, this is my perception on how this is supposed to be done as an industry standard, so let's kind of respect that and have a good time and not overdo ourselves, because do you want to come back, or do you just want to have an all-star good time the one time, you know?
Yeah.
What will get you blacklisted from a barrel?
Oh, yeah. There you go. What gets you blacklisted?
If you're the one that controls the allocations, you can control the blacklist too.
Yeah, sure.
I guess I would say, man, coming from a former like person, I used to smoke cigarettes. Like, I've literally had people like, we're waiting on like, you know, a person to get here, we're going to go outside and smoke a cigarette. And we're kind of like,
smoking cigarettes at a distillery.
Yeah. And then like coming in, being in a room and you can like, that stuff is potent. Like you can smell that on somebody. Or I've had people drinking coffee as we're doing a single barrel selection.
What? How do you drink coffee?
Like literally drinking coffee, like a Starbucks, like in sitting in the barrel rooms. Like,
I've got one
caramel macchiato.
Yeah.
I've got one that trumps that though.
Oh, I can't wait to hear this.
This guy, I used to get super upset about the cigarette thing too, but I've just kind of washed that out of my mind. I had a guy come in, he pulls out Kodiak Wintergreen.
Oh gosh.
He looks at me and he said, I was like, are you about to put that? He asked me for a spitter and I was like, no. And I was like, are you about to put that in right now? And he's like, yep. He's like, I've been drinking whiskey with a dip in my mouth ever since I started and I'm not going to stop. And I was like, all right, you guys are buying it, so roll tide and let's rammer jammer this barrel out of here.
Roll tide.
That's hilarious.
Oh man,
nothing like Wintergreen Skull.
Golly, I was gonna say the only time I've done that was back
just
in college
up in my mouth.
Oh yeah, I wanted to throw up too. Like,
whew. I don't know if it's a blooper, but I won't mention what group it was. We had like a brand new bourbon group that came about, right? Like they didn't even know all their members.
The worst, the Facebook groups.
Yes, yes.
Are they really?
So that's a good point. This Facebook group comes in. So they haven't met all the members there, and like they auctioned off like who gets to come in and help pick the barrel. Well, there was this couple down there that came in the distillery, and like the lead of their group immediately greeted them, right? Like, oh yeah, yeah, like, you're here for barrel pick. And they're like, yeah. So they come with us on this tour. They come up in the barrel pick room. They do the barrel pick. They're in the barrel pick room. And at some point, you know, I had all the samples curated out. They slam him back, like him and his wife. And he says something like, I usually don't drink whiskey because I always try to fight people. And like the whole time, like it's an awkward tension in the stream. Like everyone's like, what is going on? And then they just get up and leave. They were never even part of the group. Like they weren't even supposed to be in there. They were just on the tour. They sat through a whole hour and a half presentation of the single barrels, right? And it was just, I still think about that like randomly.
Barrel pick crashers.
Damn, yeah. They hosed you.
Yeah. not even us. I felt bad for the guy leading it because it was like, you know, he just put together this bourbon group and he was like, guys, this is totally my fault. Like I told them to come with us and come up here. He's like, they're not even supposed to be here.
We're entrepreneurs from Vermont.
Yes. Yes.
We have a maple syrup company.
Yeah. Venture capitalist.
Yes. Venture capitalist. Yes. From Vermont.
So I want to poke one more thing there. Like, so why are Facebook groups? Like, why do you think like they're, is it just like, cause it doesn't feel like there's a foundation there yet? Or is it just like, it's an online community and it hasn't really been built?
I feel like it's more for clout for them. Is that weird to say?
No, it's
like,
not weird.
I mean, I think there are some true people like love the brands, but it's weird. I think if it's trending, they'll do it. I don't think it's like true like lovers maybe necessarily all the time. And that doesn't go for like everyone in those groups.
But it could also be like people that are like, let's say that I'm a transplant here and I'm just trying to find somebody to hang out and drink bourbon with, or I don't have any close friends. Like yeah, the internet's the closest place to be able to do it. But yeah, I mean, I agree. It's tough to find that.
And I feel like there's some snobs in those groups, man. I'm just not that way yeah, about some stuff. And
I had a Facebook group come in.
I see Macaulay's face. He's just like, oh, here we go.
I don't want to act like I know everything about everything in the world, but this was a first for me. They complained about the pour levels. And you guys have been on a pick with me. I'm not, we're not throwing down less than a little splash in there.
It's not a thimble.
It's not a thimble.
But you're not stingy either.
But he was complaining because it wasn't enough for how he poured it and because it was messing up his nose. So after that, I just kind of washed over my mind. Like, what is the proper level of whiskey in a Glencairn then? Can you tell me, sir? No, you can't. You're just being picky right now. But I don't want to jade Facebook groups or these other groups. Like, let's put it out. On one end, we might have classy connoisseurs like yourself. And then on the other end, we might have our chugging group out here.
The chuggers. I've a couple Facebook groups. Yes.
So if we're on the scale here of connoisseur to chugger,
let's find a happy
medium. Yes. Like, let's not be doing bottle kills in the parking lot, like things like that. Generally, those Facebook groups, though, they're just trying to get an allocation to flip. That's not someone that's going to help build my brand and further our success. They're there for a good time and then them tater them stickers up and dump some wax in it and glitter and whatever else they want to put on it and make $5 off of it or something. Like, so that's what perturbs me too. That's another thing too that kind of perturbs me is these other groups that come and they'll do picks, they'll sell them out instantly, and then 350% markup on their group. Like, why would you even buy that? Like, you don't even know what the juice is in there. If I just put a cool sticker on there, is that really what you want? Like, are we just buying to buy things again?
I hate it, but I love it. Because I bought in bottles, though, just for stickers. So, like, it's like a love-hate. Like, I get it, though. Like, I gotta get that. It's a cool sticker.
So, I mean, but are those things, like cringeworthy to you? Like, do you like it? Do you hate the sticker thing? Or is it kind of like, you know what? It's just a part of the game now.
It's a love-hate because I've had issues that have backlashed from it as well, too, because...
Oh, talk about that, because I know that there's distilleries that are just like, well, no, it's not us. Like,
well... In my mindset, once it leaves the loading dock, it's not my problem anymore. So not everyone else has that opinion, though.
Right.
So when you have a retailer that puts on a secondary sticker that might have, let's just say, compromised images, like I'm pulling trademark images off of the internet and using it as a barrel pick sticker, that comes down to being possible litigation against the actual distillery, distributor, store owner, and everyone else. So it has come up before. I've not ever had any like issues out of it. It was just kind of like, hey, you might want to watch out. this group did this. But essentially, you can't put athletic things on a bottle because alcohol cannot enhance athletic performance. And you can also not put things like Santa Claus on the bottle, too. And I mean,
well, let's be real. Nothing, alcohol is never going to help athletic performance. I was about to say, I was like, I've tried having a sip of whiskey and then working out, and you're just like, oh, you get gassed after 2 minutes. You're like, yeah, I'm done for the day.
It helps my betting on
video games consider athletic.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, shit, that's a $1 billion industry. So yeah,
exactly. Hey, golf, man, it makes my golf game way better.
Well, it makes you help forget how bad you're doing at golf, too. You're just like, whatever. Like, back nine, you're like, at this point, just let it rip. Who cares?
Yep.
Yeah, we always just tell people, hey, like, once it leaves the distillery, whatever you put on it, like, we're... And luckily, we haven't had any issues. But the reason I say it's a love-hate, because when a group picks a barrel, we obviously do a customized sticker for them. And sometimes that's the biggest holdup, is getting approval, because we allow them to put a logo, a name, and believe it or not, that could take several weeks, just depending on how big the chain is, how much thought they want to put in it. And then sometimes they may hit you with such an inappropriate name or image, you really got to laugh and be like, man, you all know I can't put that on the bottle. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, why can't I do that?
but it's funny. I'm like, I'm not saying it's not funny. I'm just saying we can get in a lot of trouble if we do that. Plus, we have a lawyer on site, Steve. He's great. We always go to him for anything. He checks anything. Anytime a label comes and it's even questionable, like, Steve, look this. Can you look this up for us? Because speaking of Santa Claus, you know, we had a group that did a pick and they wanted to put Corky on the front on their label, like Christmas Vacation, like that address to Santa Claus.
Yeah, I'm talking about.
And it was so cool, but we couldn't do it. We're like, it's too much trouble, guys. We can get in so much trouble for this.
Oh.
So yeah, it's a love-hate thing.
So we talked a lot some cringe things, like, because there was the cigarettes. There's the stickers. There's the parking lot chugs.
Got another one.
Macaulay's got another one.
Don't forget the skull dip.
And I, but I love this. Like, I love like hitting these things of like, just don't do this.
It's not a political thing or anything, but do not bring your gun to the distillery. Oh, I do not need you to bring your hip cannon in there to defend the distillery at that point in the day.
We've never been under attack.
So I've had to disarm someone before, like, sir, you're walking sideways because that gun's so big anyway. I think he had like a 44 Magnum or I don't know. It was a leg cannon. It's like, brother, you got to go put that in truck real quick and come back in. Apparently, you have to be the distillery owner to be able to carry a gun on the distillery property is what the law says. So.
I did not know that. Well, what about you, John? Is there any kind of like last little cringeworthy thing that you've ever seen or something that did you look at and you're just like, man, I wish these people just didn't do this? Or
I think it's amazing how people just open up doors or go places they shouldn't, like in the distillery.
Wow.
Like,
room, that room.
Whether it's on a tour and it's like, you know, like literally like be like, did you not see the keep out? Or like you literally had to move that chain to go past it. Like, why didn't think, like, that's one thing that always blows my mind.
Didn't apply to me though, right?
No. We're boys.
We go back 10 minutes.
Because it's such a, like, our distillery isn't big. So like, it's one of those things, like literally, like if you literally would just ask, like we barely ever say no. So, I mean, just ask. And it's just amazing, like, what people will pick up or touch or just do in a working facility.
Oh, Macaulay. I
keep thinking. I'm adding to my list over and over.
He just keeps, memories keep popping up.
Yeah. So, we have designated bathroom facilities for a reason. Don't piss on the side of the Rick House.
It's fun to focus on the negative because I think that
Those are the funny things.
Well, it's the funny things that people don't really think about. But, you know, as we kind of wrap this up, I do want to give you one chance to kind of at least focus on the positive. Like, what is like one thing, like think of at this point in the culmination of your career of like, what is like the most positive thing that's come out of the single barrel program for what you have done for each of you?
I'm a huge face of the brand, honestly. I mean, forging those interpersonal relationships with different clients that come to the distillery and have that experience with me. I mean, I still continue friendships on with a lot of different barrel groups and people that I've met over the years too. I mean, like I said, I did some other barrel picks today with some friends from New Jersey that came down. I mean, we've done Armagnac picks together. Like, I mean, it's just kind of forging those relationships that are going to keep going forward. Things that are going to be beneficial for the distillery. I think that's where it's at, just those interpersonal relationships. Because like I was saying earlier, it's not, I can send you a box of samples and you don't get anything out of it. It's just transaction. But once you come and see the place, get to kick the tires, say, oh, wow, this is a big distillery. I didn't realize it was going to be this when you pull up. Getting the vibe. How about that?
I feel you. Yeah.
Getting the vibe.
For sure.
I know. I love that. Yeah. I'd say, it's different when they get to actually come down there. But I say one of the positive things, like he said, just you can't say any better than that, just the connections, the people. I mean, we're in about 47 different states, but I still think maybe just Alaska. There's not a state I don't think I could go in and call somebody just that I've met through the barrel program or whatnot and been like, hey, man, can I crash on your couch or you want to get a drink or
100%.
Like, let's hang out. And that's like the most rewarding thing. And I always tell people, you know, I've done the mashing, I've done the distillation, but like none of those are nearly as rewarding to me as running that program. And one of the biggest to me is like when people come in, they taste this and they just say like, wow, like, these samples are so different. Like, this is crazy. Like, the flavor. Because, you mean, you work hard on that. I mean, that's when you're kind of the face and, you know, you grow to be one of the faces of a company or brand or distillery and they come in, you know, you've put the hard work and it may only be three samples, but they don't know what it took to get those three samples there. And that's one of the biggest compliments someone can give you when they love your selection. They're like, can I buy all three of these? And you want to say yes, but you know, you're like, no, you can only take one. But
I only got 12.
Yeah. And that's just one of the biggest compliments, I think, is when people come in and you just see the excitement there. And then they're pumped up, like, we're going to sell all of this. And, you know, and that's just, it's so rewarding. Cause you're seeing, even though I didn't make the juice, it's still, I got to curate those samples.
Yeah, but you
selection.
Pick it out, you got your little stamp on it.
Yeah,
you
know? And they know that I thought this one was good to be in the program.
And they liked it.
And they liked it. To me, that's one of the biggest things. And I would run the program as long as they'll let me just because I enjoy the connections. I enjoy being in front of people. You know, they've done the distillation, but I did a couple weeks of distillation. I was like, I can't do this. Like, no, I don't want to be, in front of the screen doing this and that, like put me in front of people.
Just let me taste it.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Well, I think you got the better part tasting the aged whiskey.
Yeah.
That's the better part. Mm-hmm. That's the better part.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, guys, I want to say thank you so much for coming on the show today. It was fantastic. Kind
of a lot of fun.
God, that went quick.
I know.
See, when you start talking about whiskey and single barrels,
we didn't even get to the cookies.
We'll save the cookies for after show here.
What's in those?
Yeah.
Wilderness Trail weeded bourbon and snickerdoodles, of course.
Very nice.
Nice.
I love snickerdoodles.
But guys, I do want to say thank you so much for coming on here and being able to kind of tell your story, tell the story behind the brand and really what you do. And now that we know that if somebody does have a close relationship on you, you're now a potential couch surfer for them. So
yes,
that's good to hear.
I also enjoy getting a nice gift too. So if you bring me a fine ball at Armagnac, you might get a better barrel the next year you come around.
Hey, Vinny just picked a barrel of
Armagnac. I always joke with people
about stock,
that.
Your stock went up 100 points.
We got one from
there we go.
Right there, so. There you go.
Once we turn off the air here, we're going to go to the back room and start finding stuff for these guys.
Oh, yeah. Got some Ellen Cantata.
Shit, we might even white label one for you at this point.
There we go. But guys, seriously, thank you so much. If people do want to either follow you online, on Instagram, wherever it is, like, how do they follow you? And if they have, they're like, oh, I got a 501c3. Can I get a private barrel? No, I'm just kidding. But seriously, how can they follow you?
Reach out to the distributor.
Yeah, that's a good response.
Reach out to our distributor. You can actually, I'm on Instagram. That's probably my favorite social media platform. And the Bourbon Swami is my tagline there. I'm also on Clubhouse as well, too, if you guys are available for Whiskey Wednesdays. We're there every week, so chime in on that sometime as well, too.
Cool.
Instagram is my main platform. You can find me at sir_jwadle, or just email me, john@kentuckypeerless.com.
Might not get
story.
An answer, but
it might be a few hours. It'll get back.
Yeah, just give me at least 5 to 7 business days to respond.
We'll post his cell phone number in the show notes for you guys.
There you go.
Hey, that's honestly the fastest way to reach me. I don't know if I should put that on a podcast.
We won't put it out there.
No.
Guys, free barrel requests, call this number.
There you go.
Yes.
But guys, dude, thank you so much for coming on. This was a pleasure. It was a fun conversation. We got to really learn some insights. And I think for us, I love hearing the things that you shouldn't do. Or
we've
just
been there and we can
the
understand.
Bloopers. I love the bloopers.
Yeah, it's, you know, a barrel pick's a magical experience. And we we don't take it for granted because it's so much fun, and we're so thankful that you all put that on for folks. And it's a fun to hear like your other experiences and stuff too. So
yeah, absolutely. So make sure you follow them. Make sure you follow us where you reach your podcast, and follow us on all the socials at Bourbon Pursuit. And with that, make sure you subscribe, and we'll see you all next week.
Toodles.
Cheers.